So going back again to our mv equals py, now I'm going to concentrate on the form which makes a prediction about prices compared to the money supply. So here's prices. Compared to the money supply, the velocity of money, how fast money changes hands, which we can take as a measure of financial technology and interest rates, also to some degree consumer sentiment or something like that. Whether or not people feel the need to have a large precautionary balance in their checking account, say, for instance, and real GDP. And you can see, if you look at this, and I'm going to rewrite it so that it's less cluttered, you can see that the prediction is the price level depends upon the ratio of these things. So, for instance, if M is fixed, and GDP, Y, grows, what happens to prices? Well, you can maybe see here that this thing is going to go up, that prices are going to go up. But let's go ahead and construct a little numerical example, because sometimes you may not have a mathematical intuition here. So let's suppose that initially the money supply is 100, velocity is 2, and that's about what it is in the long run in the United States for the measure of money called M2. And the real GDP is, say, 200. No, that's going to make everything come out too easy. So real GDP is going to come to be 100. Okay. So if that's true, I'm going to plug these numbers in here, and I'm going to get a prediction that the money supply times the velocity divided by GDP gives us a price level of 2. So now let's go ahead and ask our question here. What if we rerun this calculation, but now with GDP, say for instance, of 200? So now we're going to go the price level is 100 times 2 over 200, where the price level is 1. So notice that if the money supply is fixed and the real economy is growing, we are going to experience deflation. And this is actually what happened for much of the 1800s when we did have a gold standard. So the gold supply was relatively fixed. Yes, people did discover new gold supplies and so on and so forth from time to time, but it was pretty fixed. And the economy was growing pretty strongly as the US and Western Europe were going through the Industrial Revolution. And we actually saw, year by year, that there tended to be deflation. And you might be tempted to say that, well, if inflation is a bad thing, which most people think it is, then deflation is a good thing. But it actually doesn't really work that way, probably. One is the problem of debts. So when you have deflation or negative inflation, then you're going to have higher real interest rates. Because remember, the real interest rate, R, is the nominal interest rate minus the inflation rate. Well, if you have deflation, then the inflation rate is negative, and the real interest rate is actually higher than the nominal rate. And this was actually a big problem for farmers during the late 1800s in the United States. They would see that they had borrowed money, say, for instance, to buy or expand their farm, and every year crop prices got lower and lower and lower. So the amount of crop that they actually had to sell to service their loans actually went up and up and up each year. And there was this big sort of, you know, free silver and so on and so forth, and William Jennings Bryan, and this big sort of political struggle over the money supply and whether or not it should be expanded at that time. So generally speaking, we don't think that deflation is a good thing. Deflation also tends to produce a situation where consumers have a big incentive to always delay their purchases. And so in a modern economy, we actually see that deflation tends to be associated with fairly severe recessions or economic stagnations. So the main modern example is Japan, after their simultaneous stock market and real estate bubble burst around 1990. Which is the cause and which is the effect there is a little bit tricky. It's probably some of both. Both their recession caused some deflation, but the deflation also kept their recession going for a long time. And they've basically lost about 10 or 20 years of economic growth. So, again, if we want to have a prediction of where the price level is going to go, we're going to look at this thing and try to predict what's happening to this ratio here.